Welcome to Session 1 of Being the Believing. As I said by way of introduction, the first four Beatitudes deal with what we get. And so Session 1 is Rags to Riches, and it's found in Matthew chapter number 5, verse number 1. Before we go in, let me just tell you a little bit about my history. I've been a pastor for about 25 years, and in those 25 years, I've seen the power of the church dissipate as I have watched Christians slide into mediocrity and complacency, leaving a world confused at best and hostile toward the gospel at worst. This study will look at the Sermon on the Mount, the greatest sermon ever preached by the greatest preacher that ever lived. John Stott calls the Sermon on the Mount the most complete delineation anywhere in the New Testament of the Christian counterculture. This study is for both the non-Christian and the believer. For those that have never surrendered to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, I pray that this session will reveal the truth that you will never have purpose and you will never find meaning in your life until you are first reconciled to God through the atonement made by the Son of God, Jesus Christ, in His death, His burial, and His resurrection. To the follower, the disciples of Christ, my prayer is that through this study, that God may reveal areas of your life that need to be changed, that can be changed, and that at the end of our time together, you will be able to proclaim with integrity, I am being the believing. Years ago, I had a decision to make: pursue my doctorate in philosophy and education, a PhD, or a doctorate in education, an EDD. One is a research degree, the other is a practical degree. In other words, the PhD would put me into books learning, and the EDD would put me in the field doing. That is the best way I can use to describe the theology in the Bible in this transition to the Beatitudes. In other words, we go from theology learning to the Beatitudes doing. That is why I have entitled this series, Being the Believing. And how important it is for modern day Christians living in such a sinful, wicked, perverse generation that was best described as Vance Havner when he said the world has become so churchy and the church so worldly, you can't even tell the two apart. How important it is for modern day Christians living in such a wicked culture to start living out what they know and believe to be truth. To take what you learn in Sunday school through sermons, your personal devotions, your prayer, your intimate walk with Jesus Christ, and actually do something with that knowledge. It's great that you know that you are to forgive as Christ has forgiven you, but it's powerful when you actually forgive someone that has offended you. It's nice that you know you should mourn over your sin, but when's the last time you truly hit your knees in tears, broken that you have hurt the very heart of God? So let's get started in session one as we unpack this first beatitude found in Matthew chapter 5, verse number 1. Seeing the crowds, he went up to the mountain, and when he sat down, his disciples came to him. So, number one, the God of the universe sees, cares, and is able. For God to see you is for God to know you, and for God to know you is for God to care about you. Here we have in our text these crowds that have gathered at the feet of Jesus, waiting with great expectation and anticipation of truths that could transform their very lives. And the first thing pointed out is that Jesus saw them. As a child, when we got hurt, maybe riding our bikes and scraping our knee, the first thing we did intrinsically is look around to see if our parents were watching, if someone bigger and greater than us could see us. And as parents, oftentimes with our children, especially when they were doing something a little out of the norm or out of their comfort zone, we would shout out for them to hear us, "I see you." And that sort of meant that everything was okay. Someone more powerful, more caring, willing and able was watching. How fast we forget this truth about our relationship with God when we feel that we are drowning at the very deep end of the pool of life. Like the Israelites who were in slavery for 400 years, they clung to the promises of God that one day He would redeem them and save them and release them from slavery. Yet generation after generation was born, they lived, they died still in slavery with the promises of freedom just a faded memory. Yet one day God called Moses to the mountain of God and he says this, I have surely seen the affliction of my people who are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry because of their taskmasters. I know their sufferings. Exodus 3:7. Again, for God to see us is for God to know us, and for God to know us is for God to care about us. How amazing it is to know that the God of the universe sees us, cares about us, and is able to move to work in our very lives. No wonder this verse ends with, "His disciples came to him." When we really get that God sees us, that he knows us, that he cares about us, and he wants to help us, our natural response is to position ourselves as close to him as possible. Friend, please believe today that the God of the universe sees you, cares about you, and is able. Number two, because God cares, he has earned the right for our attention. Verse 2 says, he opened up his mouth and he taught them, saying, here we have people, according to Matthew 4, verse 16, that have been sitting in darkness, isolated, insulated, lonely, overwhelmed, and defeated in life. People that have been drawn to the light by Jesus Christ, rescued from depravity, and compelled to listen to the voice of God because of the love of God. That sounds just like us. There was a time that we were in darkness, controlled by our emotion, our feelings, yielding to sin, isolated, insulated, overwhelmed, defeated, and rightfully so, because the Bible says that we were children of wrath, destined to spend an eternity separated from the love of God in that place called hell, according to Romans 6:23. But then John 3:16 steps up and gives us the great news. But then God gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. There is a story of a young Jonathan Falwell who went with his dad, Jerry Falwell, on a trip. They were unable to find a return flight home, and Larry Flint, the founder of the pornographic magazine Hustler, he invited Dr. Falwell on a ride in his private jet back home. Pastor Falwell agreed, and there they sat in a luxury jet next to the very king of pornography. Jonathan remembers his dad and Mr. Flint. They talked about basketball the entire trip. Once they landed, Jonathan was quick to ask his dad, "Dad, why didn't you share Jesus Christ with him?" To which Dr. Falwell replied, "I have to earn that right." And he did just that. He paved the way for many in years to come to do the very same. In fact, a few years ago, I was attending a conference in New Orleans. And it was the same time that Larry Flint was opening up a brand new strip club in town. I asked my wife for the money to cover the charge to get in, rented a car, went shopping for the nicest Bible I could find, and then I stood in line to speak with Mr. Flint. When I arrived at the table, I gave him the Bible and I started to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. I was surrounded by scantily clad women and bodyguards. He put his hands on that Bible, teared up, he got emotional, and he looked at me and he said, "You must be one of Jerry's kids." Jerry Falwell earned the right to share the gospel with this man by showing him over years that he actually cared for him. Years later, Mr. Flint sent one of his books to Dr. Falwell asking if he could write the foreword. Jesus, who has rescued us from our depravity, saved us by his sacrifice, redeemed us through his grace, showered us with his blessings, and compelling us to listen to his voice because of his love. I would say he has earned the right for our attention. And Deuteronomy 18:15, Moses writes, "The Lord your God will raise up you a prophet like me from among you, from your brothers. It is to him you shall listen." Speaking of Jesus. What does he say when we give him our attention? Matthew 5:3, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." He is saying that, number three, God's blessings only come to those that seek his approval. Let me draw your attention to that word blessed and point out what it does not mean. Blessed does not mean happiness that is tethered to feelings and emotions which are anchored in externals that fluctuate and change. Rather, this word blessed is speaking of an inner complete satisfaction that is tethered to Jesus Christ. It's not subject to emotion, fear, or circumstance, things that change. It's an inner joy that's established in God that was not given to this world, so it can't be taken by this world. So blessed, in my humble interpretational definition, simply means approved by God. So we can read verse number 3 thusly. Approved of God are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. So in order to be approved of God, which I'm sure everybody would, in order to be approved of God, then we must be poor in spirit, according to verse number 3. So what does poor in spirit mean? Well, let me point out, starting out, what it doesn't mean. It doesn't mean that you have no value. God does not bless somebody that has no value because that person doesn't exist. All of humanity has values in the eyes of the Lord. Zephaniah 3:17 speaks to this. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you, which means dancing over you with loud singing. Oh, friend, don't you believe the devil's lie today that you have absolutely no value? You are a creation of the living God, created in his image and in his likeness, the object and the expression of his love. And it doesn't speak of materialistic stuff. Being poor in spirit doesn't mean that you have no money. The Apostle Peter declared in Acts chapter 10, verse 34, "Truly, I understand that God shows no partiality." And it doesn't speak of a showy humility. This is not speaking of someone that takes great pride in their humility. The Greek word for poor employed here actually means to cower and cringe like a beggar, to be pitiful, inferior, and even worthless. As much as this might hurt your self-image, the word for poor used in Luke 16, used to describe a sore-ridden, diseased-carrying, poorer than poor reproach to society, is the same word used in our text in Matthew 5:3, to cower and cringe like a beggar. So we could read Matthew 5:3 this way. Approved of God are those that cower and cringe like a beggar, the pitiful, the inferior, the worthless. Theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Paul in 1 Timothy 1:15 said, "I am the chiefest of all sinners." Even Isaiah in Isaiah 6:5 cried out, "Woe unto me, I am lost, I am a man of unclean lips." Even Gideon, this mighty warrior of God who delivered Israel with just 300 men, acknowledged to God, "I am the least in my father's house." The Isaac Watts hymn at the cross, he said this, "Would he devote that sacred head for such a worm as I?" And King David, a man after God's own heart, declared in Psalm 22:6, "I am a worm and not a man." The great William Carey, known as the father of modern missions, had put on his gravestone these words. William Carey, born August 17th, 1761, died June 9th, 1834. Listen, "A wretched, poor, and helpless worm, on thy kind arms I fall." Friend, you must come to the place that you believe, and I mean really, truly believe, that you are a wretched, miserable, beggarly, poor, sinning worm that needs someone outside of you, bigger than you, greater than you, to help you and to rescue you. To embrace the formula found in Isaiah 41, "For I am the Lord your God, who upholds your right hand, who says to you, do not fear, I will help you. Do not fear, you worm Jacob, you men of Israel, I will help you, declares the Lord." So for all the worms like me out there, understand that God's blessings only come when we seek his approval. So the question is, are you ready to be blessed by God today? My prayer is that as we conclude this session, that you will be able to declare through a heart of integrity the words and the heart of William Carey, "A wretched, poor, and helpless worm, on thy kind arms I fall." And when you do that, God, through his grace, motivated by his love, will bring you from rags to riches.